Okay, I think we're going to get going. So, without further ado, let me introduce Tony, who has spent a lot of time on this issue, thinking about how to help biologists think mathematically.
Thank you very much, Sally. This is my first time attempting to do this taped, so I'm just going to try to be as natural as possible. Please do the same. So I always like to start by asking, how many of you have at least heard of hidden Markov models? How many of you feel that you understand how hidden Markov models work? Okay. But that looks like on total maybe about 3.4 hands or so. How many feel that when you're teaching this to your students, that your students can not only use them, but can understand how they work?
They not use them?
Can both use them and understand how they work. And that's a nice round zero. So that's often one of the difficulties, is figuring out how to take some of these computational and mathematical ideas and explain them to students in a logical way. And the thing is, hidden Markov models do involve some math and some computation, but it's not especially hard. And we found that if you take them through it step by step, often that helps to demystify the process, and along the way it also demonstrates why generally we use computational tools, because what you may have noticed, there aren't any computers up here. So we're going to do some hidden Markov models by hand, some simple hidden Markov models. At the end of this, it will become abundantly clear to you and to your students why generally we use computers to do the repetitive grunt work. But let's start off just by talking about the idea of hidden Markov models in general. So, a Markov process is any process, I should note, it's a probabilistic process whose probabilities depend only on the current state of the system, not on any previous states. That is, if you want to know the probability that it will rain tomorrow, you might need to know the probability that it rained today, but you don't need to know anything about what's happened in the last couple of days. It depends only, where you're going for your next step depends only on where you are right at one time. This is handy in many cases because it means the system doesn't need to have a really extensive memory. The hidden side of things deals with the fact that what we're going to be trying to figure out is not something that you can directly observe. So we are trying to infer a series of states that are not directly observable. For example, we might not, you know, if we're spending all day indoors at a conference like this with the windows down, we might not know whether it rained at any point during the day. But in the evening when we go out, if you see that there's a wet sidewalk, then you can infer that it probably rained unless the sprinkler system broke down. Hidden Markov models are used in many situations that have sort of a linear type of data structure. For instance, they're used in speech recognition. Right now, what all of you are hearing are this string of phonemes coming out of my mouth, and you are classifying them, breaking them up into individual words. Speech recognition software uses the same thing to try to break apart this string into identifying what words are present. In the case of bioinformatics, hidden Markov models are often used where the observable states are sequence, whether DNA sequence, amino acid sequence, or sequence of other type, and the hidden layer has to do with the, we can think about this as the underlying structure or organization. For instance, you could use hidden Markov models on an amino acid sequence to say, okay, where are there likely alpha helices and beta sheets? You don't directly see those in the amino acid sequence, but you can infer where they probably are. In today, what I'd like to do is follow a primer that was designed by Sean Eddy, and what we're going to do is use DNA sequence to infer basically where within a particular gene we transition from an exon to a 5' splice site and then to an intron. So this is going to be the hidden part. The observed part will be the DNA sequence itself. Any questions so far? People are reasonably okay with this? Okay, so let us start this off. I'm going to be drawing up a series of vectors and matrices that describe the system, and it's been pointed out that it's helpful to understand where these things come from. So, I'm going to start with sort of a general diagram of the system. Think of this as a flowchart, if you like. So when we are obtaining DNA sequence, we start at a particular position, and in this nice simplistic model, let me emphasize, I'm going to follow Eddie's example of using a grossly oversimplified gene. Some of you are going to be screaming because you're going to say, genes don't look like that. No, okay, granted. But once we see how it works, making a lot of oversimplified assumptions, you can then think, okay, how would we take this to apply it to what I actually know about the structure of a gene? So in this example, we're going to be starting in an exon part of a gene. That's where our first nucleotide is. We may then continue in the exon for some unknown number of nucleotides before moving on to the 5' splice site. Unrealistic assumption number one. We're going to assume that the splice site is exactly one nucleotide long. You know that's wrong, but it's going to make our lives easier for now. If it's exactly one nucleotide long, it doesn't loop back to itself. Instead, after the 5' splice site, you go directly to the intron, where you can stay for some unknown number of nucleotides. And then at some point, you reach the end of your read. In a real sequence, of course, you might then hit a 3' splice site. You might go to another exon. You might reach the end of the gene. All of these lovely complications. We're keeping it simple by focusing only on the area around the 5' splice site. Are people okay with this? So let's now describe this model with an initialization vector. An initialization vector describes the probability of starting in the different states. In this case, this is our state model. And our three different states are exon, the 5' splice site, and the intron. So, in this model, what is the probability that our first nucleotide is in an exon? 1. 100% of the time. That's an assumption we're making for now. Later on, we'll talk about relaxing that assumption. Theoretically, you could start at the 5' splice site, or you could start in an intron. Under this model, what are the probabilities of those events? 0. And when you're working with your students, depending on how much probability and statistics they've had, it can be worth asking them, what's a good thing to check at this point to make sure you haven't made some horrible error? What should be true of these three numbers? They'd better add up to 1. And of course, none of them had better be less than 0 or greater than 1, or you have bad things happening. Okay, so far. Next, let us draw out a transition matrix. This is going to tell you the probability at any one nucleotide, given the state where you were, this will tell you the probability of being in a given state at the next step. Remember, this is the Markov part of things. Given that it rained today, what is the probability that it will rain tomorrow or be sunny tomorrow? So let's look at the probabilities from our three states. So going from an exon, a 5' splice site, or an intron, to, when we're looking at going two states, now we have a fourth possibility, which is at some point we're going to reach the end of the read. So let's fill this in. And some of these we can already fill in from this diagram. For example, what is the probability of going, according to this model, what's the probability of going directly from the exon to the intron? 0. What other automatic zeros do we have here? Going from the exon to the end. Sorry? From the intron to the exon. No backwards genes, please. From the splice site to the exon. More, I want more zeros. From the splice site to the end. From the splice site to the splice site. Didn't draw a loop. And if I'm doing this correctly, from the intron to the 5' splice site, also a 0. One more of these numbers we can immediately fill in. 5' to the intron, what's the probability of that?
1.
Because from the 5' splice site, you have to go somewhere. We've already ruled out the others, so this has a probability of 1. And notice what that's telling you is that the sum of this row has to be 1. And in fact, the sum of each row has to be 1. Now, a little harder is figuring out what the probabilities are of these other situations. And that's going to depend on your biological knowledge. I'm going to give you some numbers here and then talk about what they mean. So, 60% probability of staying in an exon, 40% probability of going from an exon to a splice, 80% of staying at an intron, 20% chance of going from an intron to an end. So, how long is an exon? Are all exons going to be the same length according to this model? I could, there's a 40% chance that I hit an exon and immediately go to the 5' splice site, but I could go around this loop a few times. We don't know exactly how many times. Likewise, when I hit the intron, I could go around that loop a few times before hitting the end. In this model, which of those loops am I likely to spend more time in? The exon loop or the intron loop? The intron loop has a higher probability of looping around. What does that mean about the relative lengths of an exon versus an intron? The intron is larger, according to these numbers, because it has a higher in-loop probability. So based on your estimates of the relative length of exons and introns, that is how you are going to adjust these numbers. It is possible to show mathematically, I'm not going to do that for now, though if people want to, I can show them later. We can write this 0.2, the probability of ending, as 1/5. So that's the probability of going from an intron to the end. This corresponds to an average intron is of length 5 base pairs, just the reciprocal of 1/5. In reality, of course, introns are generally much longer than 5 base pairs, which means this number is going to be very, very small, and correspondingly, this is going to be a large number, almost 1, maybe 0.999. Yes, sir?
I guess I don't understand why it's not 1. I think the model just keeps going until the end of the sequence, right?
Yes.
And the way I'm reading your state model is that the end of the sequence is going to be in the intron. And so you're always going to end at an intronic base pair. So why isn't it just 1? And then when you get to the end of the sequence, it's just over.
And this is a subtle point that we've often talked about. The idea is that these are the probabilities before you start sequencing. Now, given once you actually have done your sequence, you do know that that last nucleotide is definitely an intronic nucleotide. You're absolutely right. You don't know about the previous one. That could be either a 5' splice site or an intron. And likewise, you don't know further back in. But these are the probabilities that are established before you start sequencing.
So do you have the end there as sort of a placeholder to be something potentially after the end?
The end is here actually because if you look at this in a formal mathematical sense, this is the way that you get the total probability of all sequences to add up to 1 as it needs to. You can think about what's the probability of generating different state paths under this sequence. I could, for instance, do this is one possible state path where it would start at an exon, go around the loop 2 more times, hit the 5' splice site, go to the intron, hit it once more, and then go to the end. I can list all possible state paths that fit this model, and that total will add up to 1. If you don't include the ending condition, then you lose that property. Now, we've talked about this before with other groups, and from a biological standpoint, you may not really care. Those end probabilities are basically going to end up dropping out. But if, like me, you sort of come from a hybrid math-bio background, you really like things to sort of every I be dotted and every T be crossed. Fair enough?
Yeah, that's great.
Other questions to this point? So, in fact, we have one more piece of information we're going to need, which is the emission matrix. And the emission matrix is the probability that if you're in an exon, a 5' splice site, or an intron, the probability of emitting a particular nucleotide. Again, this is going to be based on your biological knowledge about the base composition of exons, introns, and 5' splice sites. So let me give you, say, some initial guesses. In reality, you're probably going to want to base this on a good knowledge of your system. What do these numbers mean, I'm assuming, about the exon? Uniform base frequencies. That's probably not exactly correct. We could fine-tune it a bit, but let's start here. Following Eddy, I'm going to assume that the splice site always occurs at a guanine. Again, not realistic, and later on we can relax that. How about in an intron? Are we going to have uniform base frequencies in an intron, or is there some kind of bias one way or the other? Introns are generally rich in adenine and thymine. So let's reflect that here. Again, these precise numbers may not be the best fit to your model, but knowing your system as well as you do, you should put in numbers that are a good fit for your system.
Now, by system,
the gene in question that you're looking at in the particular model organism you're looking at, or the gene region, is what I'm thinking of. Did you have something else in mind?
Yes, I would have said you're thinking about average for a given organism. So any given organism will have a particular GC richness of the genome. If we have some knowledge of transcribed regions and so on, we may be able to make those numbers more accurate. In terms of what's known about gene composition.
Exactly. So you want to use this knowledge, you want to take into account the fact that these frequencies in an intron may be somewhat different from what they would be in an intergenic region. So some parts of the chromosome may be under different biases. So there are a number of factors that can go on. But theoretically, you and your students have all of this delicious biological information that you are using to spice up the model. Fair enough? You can start to see what happens when you use a hidden Markov model without all of this information. It's the old garbage in, garbage out philosophy. Well, enough talk. Let's start doing some computation. So, I am going to give you a particular DNA sequence. And since you're going to be doing this by hand, let's keep it short. Problem number one for you. Figure out all the possible state paths for this particular sequence. For example, this first A could be part of an exon. Perhaps this first G is the 5' splice site, these next two are introns, and then we hit the end. That is a valid state path that fits this model. Are there other state paths that also are consistent with this model? Can you say that again, please? Perhaps the second G is the 5' splice site, which would make these first two exons, this an intron, and then the end. What's the probability that this first nucleotide is going to be in an exon? By definition, the probability is 1. What's the probability that we've gone directly from an exon to a 5' splice site at the next spot? 0.4. So we can fill in the corresponding probabilities for all of these. 5' to an intron, probability is 1. Intron to intron, 0.8. And intron to end, 0.2. Because this is a Markov model, that means that these probabilities are independent of each other. How do we combine independent probabilities? You multiply them. So, what is the probability of getting this state path? .64? 0.064? 0.0064? Or 0.0064? So when I did it, this is what I got, 0.064. This is consistent with other people's? I always tell students, trust but verify. Sometimes within a lab group, one person will do the calculations and everyone else will copy them down. And it's like, really? Do you want to put your entire lab grade in that one person's hands? And when you phrase it like that, they, well, no, here, let me check. The person who did the calculations is also really relieved at that point. It's like, okay, pressure is off. Please then give me the probability for state path 2. .048. Let's have some other people see what they get. When you get an answer, please just call it out. We have one vote for 0.048. A confirmation. Let's get a third opinion. We have a third opinion. And that's because here that's 1.0 times 0.6 times 0.4 times 1.0 times 0.2. That should multiply out to 0.048, if I've done it correctly. Yes, sir.
In the computer, when they come up with all of the state paths, because there's some pretty boring ones there, like
E. Oh, absolutely. And in fact, some of them make no sense at all. So, what would be, for instance, the probability of getting E, 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 end? Why would it be 0? Because this would require us to go directly from the exon to the end, which has a probability 0, and of course, when that's present in your multiplication, the whole thing comes out to 0. So it depends on how the computer program is coded. If it's a dumb brute force approach, you're going to have a lot of dumb state paths that are in there with probability 0. A more intelligent piece of software would prune those out early and just determine the ones that are going to give you a non-zero probability. But if you include them, hey, no harm done. You're just considering things of zero probability. Okay so far? How many people feel that they understand how to calculate the probability of these state paths? Sally, you look flummoxed or concerned. Oh, no, we haven't. So far, all we've gotten is the state path.
Right.
Next, we're going to use the emission matrix. Is that, you're just wanting to jump ahead?
I want to use that information.
Let's do that then.
Could I just ask
Oh, of course.
First, could you explain why you can't have in this model
mm-hmm.
that off the E, off the 5' splice, and off the intron are the ends?
That why you can't go directly from the exon to the end?
That you have alternate, so you can go either stay in E, go to the 5' splice, or end.
Mm-hmm. So.
E end would be viable.
Oh, you could absolutely have a model with that, and what that would be saying, in effect, is that I'm not sure that my read actually spanned the 5' splice site. Following Eddy, I've taken the initial assumption that yes, you do know that your read did that. But exactly, just as in reality, you don't know that you're going to start in the exon. So your actual model is going to be substantially more complicated. And that's one of the fun exercises I give to my students after all this, as I say, now let's model a real gene that has 3' splice sites and may have multiple exons. And you end up with something, it's not hugely more complicated, but it's enough more complicated that they have to think about it. But in the meantime, let's get to Sally's point. This is just the probability of getting this state path. But now I want to ask, if we did get that state path, what's the probability of getting the actual sequence we did? So the probability of the observed sequence given state path 1. So if this first nucleotide is in an exon, what's the probability in that exon of emitting an adenine? .25. That's what we described earlier in our emission matrix. Under the assumption that this first guanine is the 5' splice site, well, given that we're in a 5' splice site, what's the probability of emitting a guanine? 1. Can you give me the next probabilities in an intron of emitting a guanine? 0.1. In an intron emitting a thymine? 0.4. The end, we don't worry about, because the end, by definition, does not emit a nucleotide. So, how do we combine all of these? Again, they're independent, so we can multiply them. So the total probability of the observed sequence, if we follow the first state path, is what? And this is why you were given the paper. 001, I've heard once.
Twice.
Three times is the charm. We're all right or all wrong together. That's the same thing I got, so theoretically four times. Likewise, I'd ask you to calculate the probability of getting the same observed sequence given state path 2. Go. call out an answer when you have one. Feel free to raise your hand if you're stuck. Ma'am? 0025? Others? Zero, zero, 0025, going twice. I see more nods of agreement. And when I did this, I got 0.025. Okay. There we are. So now I know the probability of following state path 2. And if I followed state path 2, I can generate the probability of the observed sequence. So now let me combine those two probabilities to get the probability of the observed sequence and state path 2. Theoretically, this might make more sense if you think about it in the other order. What's the probability that first you follow state path 2, and then given that you did that, that you generated the observed sequence? Probability that we follow state path 2 is 0.048. If we did that, then we have 0.025 of generating the observed sequence. So what do we do to those two probabilities? Multiply them together. Which yields 0012. Is this what other people are getting as well? 0.0012. That is what I got as well. And we could do something similar for the probability of the observed sequence and state path 1. I will just give you, well, you can probably see how that's going to work. That's going to be 0.00064, thanks to the magic of the decimal system. So know what we've done. We've calculated the probability of each state path. We've calculated the probability of the observed sequence assuming that state path, and then we've combined those probabilities just by multiplying them. Okay, so far? Notice that if we add these together, we get something much, much less than 1. Why? There are lots of other possible state paths, there are lots of other observed sequences. Particularly, the observed sequences are going to throw us off. However, we know something about the observed sequence, which is, we know that it was observed. Any poker players here, or people who have been known to play poker on occasion? Okay, let's say that we know that Mary has 3 kings in her hand. Now that could be a 3 of a kind, it could be a full of house, it could be 4 of a kind. All of those are very unlikely. Any of those would make her very happy. And we don't know the probability. However, once we know that she has 3 kings in her hand, the probability of all of those goes up. And what will those probabilities then add up to? Those are the possibilities. If she has three of a kind in her hand, then that's either all she has, or she has a full house, or she has four of a kind. So we can renormalize the actual probabilities, taking into account the known information. In like manner, once we know that the observed sequence was in fact observed, we can renormalize these probabilities. Those of you who know about Bayesian probability, we're applying Bayes' theorem here, to determine the likelihood of state path one given the observed sequence. And that's going to be this probability divided by the sum of these two, so that after this normalization process, the two will add up to one. So divide by 0.0064 plus 0.0012.
Yes, 4 0, 3 0.
Where are there 4 0s? Oh, you just don't like my description of this. Okay, I'm talking only about the stuff after the decimal.
No, we are also talking about stuff after the decimal.
Oh, this is actually supposed to be 4 0s after the decimal?
Yeah.
Really? Then something is wrong here. I think this probability is wrong. This is what happens when we don't check our math. You know, factor of 10, what could possibly go wrong? 0.25 times 0.4, okay, that's going to be 0.1. So we have 1 times 0.1 times 0.1, that should indeed be 0.01. Okay. So, now that we've averted catastrophe, if someone will kindly work on that, meanwhile, I'll set up the other one, the likelihood of state path 2 given the observed sequence, which of course will just be 0.0012 divided by this sum. And do we have someone who's calculated this top one? Feel free to use calculators on cell phones and the equivalent. I usually don't let my students use cell phones in class, but if that's their calculator, then I make exceptions. This is state path one, yes. So I do need one or more brave souls to actually do the calculation and check my work.
How many digits?
Two or three will be fine. 0.348. That's what someone else got as well? Okay. Which translates then to a 34.8% likelihood of state path one. Likewise, if we do state path two, that should come out to 65.2%. So, in conclusion on our calculation, which of these state paths is correct? You don't know. One is more likely than the other. Can you say with 100% confidence that one is the right? No, you can't. And this, of course, is a really fun thing to unleash on your students, that we don't know the right answer. We can favor one state path over the other. Theoretically, if we got more data, maybe by using a sequence of more than four nucleotides, perhaps you could resolve it more accurately, but in many cases, what you're going to report is not a single state path, but a cluster of state paths that combined represent the likely outcomes, where you can say, okay, the splice site is probably at one of these positions. We don't know for sure, but all the others are pretty low probability events. Yes?
Given the state path?
Yes.
It was as if we didn't know that that sequence was, quote,
correct. Exactly.
But we actually did, so it seems like
that's
kind of going in a circle.
That is the key, that is one of the key points here about using these likelihood calculations. In effect, what we're doing is, yes, we're generating the probability of the observed sequence given no a priori knowledge. In the end, we know that that sequence actually happened, but the reason we need to do that calculation is because you're seeing that even though state path 2 has a lower intrinsic probability, because under that if that state path occurred, you're likelier to get the observed sequence. We have to take that into account, and you see that the effect is that's the likelier state path. So to some extent, we are going in a circle. This is really the probability of a known event. But what you're saying is, well, if we followed state path 2, how likely is it that we would have gotten that known event? Theoretically, these might be better expressed as likelihoods rather than probabilities. But we are taking that into account, and that's going to end up skewing appropriately our results.
And the other thing I'd say is, if you're going to write a computer program to analyze sequences, you don't know what the sequences are that you're going to feed into it to analyze. So you want to do it this way, such that when the computer runs, it can draw the calculation and say, okay, I got this sequence, what are the likelihoods? And it can report back the most likely. Like if it was a G model thingy, it would report back whatever was the most likely. See, so in some ways you're right, but when you're thinking and you're writing a computer program, you're writing a computer program such that it would handle any sequence. So you don't know what the sequence is until you run the program.
Yeah. That would be a fun thing if some of your students actually tried to hard code in a particular sequence and then see what results they get. And that would give you very, very bad results. What's the probability of a 5' splice site in this bacterial genome? That had better be zero. So with this said, we're about out of time, but I just want to get you thinking about how you can use this in your own classes and to help convey this information to students. Are they going to be doing these hand calculations with an actual HMM? God, no. But the idea is that once they've done a calculation or two like this, and then they're entering it into a computer program, they've essentially opened up what was previously a black box, and now they can see what's going on underneath the math. They can see how it depends on your assumptions. One of the things you'll get the chance to do is work with an Excel sheet that does something like this, where you can tweak the various transition matrices, the emission matrices. You can see how your results depend on your initial assumptions. Recognize that you shouldn't just trust the defaults. And one of the things I like best about this approach is that this way, when you take your students into the computer lab, they're not saying, oh, I have to use a computer. But in the back of their mind, they're saying, oh my God, he or she might make me do this by hand. Thank you for letting me use a computer. Any last questions? Sarah.
So, what I like about laying it out this way is it allows you to point out to the students how little information goes into the simplest model. That is, what are we working with? We're working with the base composition. And, gee, it's a good thing that the average base composition is different between introns and exons. Otherwise, we wouldn't have any way of estimating whether we were in an intron or in an exon. And it's a good thing we know something about the distribution of the length of exons and the length of introns, because that's what we're using to try to estimate when that transition occurs. And then when they think about the model in that way, then they're not surprised by the fact that the ab initio gene finders differ from each other. In fact, one of the things that is difficult for those models to do is correctly predict which exons should be put together to make a final gene model. And then they're a little less surprised by the inaccuracies in those predictions, and they take those predictions less seriously, which I think is a good thing.
Other questions or comments? If not, I'll see you again shortly, and I'll be present at lunch if any questions come up. Right now, though, I know Wilson's going to be talking with you about sequence motifs, and I believe I have an appointment with the camera again to do all of this in a canned format. Thank you very much.